Lord bless everyone, and we're going to continue our study on Genesis 25, verse 19. And where we read and we studied Genesis 25, 1 to 18, and now we're in verse 19, and we're going to be studying that verse till verse 34 today. It starts with, "This is the genealogy of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham begot Isaac." Now, this is very important because genealogy means a record, means a history, means a lineage. Genealogy, a history of Isaac was 40 years old when he took Rebekah as his wife, the daughter of Bethuel, the Syrian of Padan Aram, the sister of Laban, the Syrian. He was 40 years old, and for 20 years, she cannot give birth. That's something, because he ends up being 60 years old when he finally is able to have his two sons. But still, for 20 years, Rebecca won't be able to give birth. And that, I can imagine, mentally, that must have been a struggle for her, because in that mindset back then, you could get a little hint of it. In Luke 1:25, Elizabeth says this, when she finally is able to give birth in her old age, she says in Luke 1:25, "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." It was a disgrace for a woman in the Middle East not to be able to give birth. It was a disgrace. A barren woman, a fruitless woman, was a disgrace. Now, this is not me saying it. This is Elizabeth saying it. In one occasion, Rachel, she tells Jacob, "Give me children or else I die." You know, it was a pride, a woman's pride, to be able to give birth in those days. Nowadays, we have people wanting to kill the baby. But back then, they actually loved their babies. And, well, we have people now that love their babies, too. They are for the baby's rights instead of women's rights. You know, in verse 20, it says, actually, we're in verse 21, it says, "Now Isaac pleaded with the Lord for his wife, because she was barren. And the Lord granted his plea, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived." This is amazing, because we look at this, and we see God as the one who is able to withhold a woman's womb and is able to open the woman's womb. In one occasion, I want to find this out. In one occasion, let me find it here. Let's see. We go to Genesis 30. And in Genesis 30, we read in Genesis 30 the following. Yes, Genesis 30, verses 1 and 2, it says, "Now, when Rachel saw that she bore Jacob no children, Rachel envied her sister and said to Jacob, 'Give me children or else I die.'" That's Genesis 30, verse 1. And verse 2, "And Jacob's anger was aroused against Rachel, and he said, 'Am I in the place of God who has withheld from you the fruit of the womb?'" These people in the Bible understood God is sovereign. God could withhold the womb from the baby, the the person could withhold the womb from the woman, could make her unbarren, or he could open up her womb. And yet, God opened the womb of Rebecca, just like he eventually did open Rachel's womb, and she was able to bear two sons, even though the last one was actually her death. Benjamin was the one. She said, "Give me children or else I die." Actually, giving children was how she died, giving birth to Benjamin. Anyway, we see Rebecca, she was able to conceive by the prayer of Isaac. We read the following in Romans 9, verse 10. "And not only this, but when Rebecca also had conceived by one man, even by her father Isaac." That's Romans 9, verse 10. And we read in 1 Chronicles 1:34, "And Abraham begat Isaac. The sons of Isaac were Esau and Israel." She was pregnant, but the children struggled together within her. And she said, "If it's all is well, why am I like this?" So she went to inquire of the Lord. Did she do it by prayer? Or she went to a prophet back in those days. People used to go to prophets. Remember Saul, King Saul, before he was King Saul? He went to inquire of Samuel because his servant told him. We read this in 1 Samuel 9, verse 9. "Formerly in Israel, when a man went to inquire of God, he spoke thus, 'Come, let's go to the seer.' For he was now called a prophet, was formerly called a seer." So they would go to a prophet, and the prophet would prophesy upon them. Possibly, maybe it wasn't she went to a prophet, maybe she went to her husband, because Isaac himself had this communion with God. He was close to God. I probably am more into that not that she went to a prophet per se, or maybe Isaac is a prophet per se, because his father was a prophet. That doesn't mean that you inherit being a prophet from your dad, but yet, when it came to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God spoke to them. Personally, God spoke to to Isaac. We're going to get to see that in a brief of God speaking to Isaac. We might not see it today, but we might see it in the next week or so when we start studying. For example, in Genesis 26, verse 2, "And then the Lord appeared to Isaac and said, 'Do not go down to Egypt, live in the land which I shall tell you.'" So God speaks. You know, God speaks to his servant. God eventually gets to speak to Isaac, just like he spoke to his dad. Isaac pleaded, and God answered. Verse 22, "But the children struggled together within her. And she said, 'If all is well, why am I like this?' So she went to inquire of the Lord. And the Lord said to her, 'Two nations are in your womb. Two peoples shall be separated from your body. One people shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger.'" Remember those words, because this is something that we're going to get back to. Because when we start going through the other chapters, especially when we get to Kings, and we'll see Israel taking possession of Edom through David, and we see the kings of Israel being over Edom, but yet we also eventually see Edom breaking that yoke from Israel's neck eventually. Okay. Actually breaking the yoke of Israel over their neck. I'm sorry. they were under the bondage, not Israel. But we see that yoke being broken. Eventually, it got broken. But they were under Israel for a time. And this prophecy is there. It leads her to doing what she does later on in the following chapters, that she would actually tell her son Jacob to dress like his brother to get the blessing, because she remembered that. She remembered what God told her. The blessing is for the younger, not for the older. The younger is the one that's chosen this time. It's kind of funny, because look at when it came to Cain and Abel. Abel was the youngest. God chose the youngest. He didn't chose the firstborn. Same thing we see with Isaac and Ishmael. God chose the youngest. And now what we see with Jacob and Esau. Esau is the oldest. God chooses the youngest. Jacob, and we'll see the same thing with Manasseh and Ephraim. God chooses Ephraim over Manasseh. God will choose the youngest. Not that God will choose the youngest. He chose David, the youngest, over his brothers that were older. But many occasions, God does choose opposite from what the world chooses. The world may choose something, but God may think differently. God doesn't work the way the world works. Back then, you're the oldest, you get the inheritance. But God likes to sometimes... God is not that God breaks the rules. Some people say, oh, God could break the rules if he wants. No, God is under no rule. He's not under any regulations. We're under God's laws, but if God wants to choose the youngest over the oldest, he can choose the youngest over the oldest. He does what he pleases. He's God. God is sovereign over everything, and we see him there in this passage as a sovereign God. Let's play a song, and then we'll continue with this study. Let's play Freely You Have Received. I haven't played that in a while. I liked that one.
Freely. as he told me to. He said, freely, freely you have received, freely, freely give. Go in my name, and because you believe, others will know that I live. Others will know that I live.
Hallelujah, glory be to God. And we read in verse 24. So when her days were fulfilled for her to give birth, indeed there were twins in her womb. And the first came out red, and he was in hairy garment all over, so they called his name Esau. The name Esau literally means hairy. And afterwards, his brother came out, and his hand took hold of Esau's heel. So his name is called Jacob. And Jacob names mean supplanter or deceitful, one who takes the heel. Because that's exactly what Jacob did. He took Esau's heel, and Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. 20 years passed. Isaac was 40 years old when he had Rebekah as his wife for the first time, and now he's in his 60s, and he's having a son in a very old age. Hosea 12, verse 3 says about Jacob, he took his brother by the heel in the womb, and in his strength he struggled with God. Yes, that's Jacob. Jacob, a mighty man. You read in Matthew 1, verse 2, Abraham begat Isaac, Isaac begat Jacob, and Jacob begat Judah and his brothers. Now, so the boys grew, and Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, but Jacob was a mild man dwelling in tents. Or that could be translated a complete man, or I wouldn't use the word complete, but well, that could be also be trying to say as complete man. He was a mild man. He wasn't a man of hunting. He in sports. Yeah, it reminds me. Esau is a lot like Ishmael. They both came out to be hunters. Ishmael was a hunter. He had his bow and arrow. And so that Esau was a hunter. And in many ways, Nimrod was also a hunter. And Isaac loved Esau because he ate of his game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. I think Rebekah was reminding constantly about the promise. Did she ever told Isaac himself? Maybe not. Maybe she kept that as a little secret between her and the Lord. I believe so, because we see Isaac, unless Isaac will later on be rebellious against God himself, and because he's blinded, and so he wants to bless Esau instead of Jacob, but I don't know. It's just assumptions that I make right now at this moment. We're going to play a song, and then we'll continue our study in verses 29 to 34. Let's play. I want to play the song, Fill My Cup, Lord. I played it yesterday, and I love that song so much. I want to hear it again. Fill My Cup, Lord.
Like the woman at the well, I
Have you told today to the Lord, fill my cup? I need my cup filled. Oh Lord, fill our cups, I pray, in Jesus' mighty name. Fill those empty voids, you know? We seek to fill our voids with things of this world that cannot fill. I remember when I was when I was first single. I'm single again because I'm a widower. But I remember when I was first single, I would ask God for a wife. And I will beg him, Lord God, if you give me a wife, I'll be filled. Well, I ended up getting married for 13 years and 11 months. And guess what? Yes, it was ups and downs in the marriage. There were some great times with my late wife. And there were some bad times as well. But there were many times, even with a wife, I still felt void. I still had to go to God, and I had to ask him, fill me, so I could be complete. Brothers and sisters, only Jesus could truly fill us. Fill that vacuum-shaped heart. Only Jesus can do that. And that is a song I need to be reminded of constantly. Fill my cup, Lord. Or like the woman in the well, you know, she had 5 husbands. Thank God not one time. But she had 5 husbands, 5 relationships, 5 marriages that failed. And the one who she was with now was not her husband. She was committing adultery. But guess what? She found, finally, the man that was able to complete her and fill her with joy, and that was Jesus. And brothers and sisters, doesn't matter who you are, you can find that man who is God Almighty, who could fill that void, because Jesus is both God and man. Oh, he fills our cup. He takes away our voidness. Hallelujah. You know, this is a great thing about being able to be recording, because when the Spirit hits me, I could speak in tongues at times. Sometimes, you know, there's some churches that I know that we're supposed to speak in tongues with interpretation. But sometimes it's good to just let it out, you know. Sometimes you're holding your tongue and you're like, oh, I want to speak in tongues. If you have that gift, if you have the gift of tongues, not everyone has it. And you're like, I want to explode. And they're telling me to hold it. And I'm trying to do it biblically. And sometimes it's so hard. You just need to explode at one time and just speak in tongues. So go ahead, brothers and sisters. If you have that gift, go speak in tongues. Anyway, brothers and sisters, it's a blessing to be able to spend time with you in this podcast. Read in verse 29, the following. It reads, now Jacob cooked a stew, and Esau came in from the field and was weary. The Amplified version says, Jacob had cooked a reddish-brown lentil stew one day when Esau came from the field and was famished. That was what eventually you read here, that it was lentil that was being cooked in verse 34. The Amplified just makes it clear from the beginning. It was a lentil stew. It was a reddish-brown soup. Verse 30. And Esau said to Jacob, please feed me from that same red stew, for I am weary. Therefore, his name was called Edom. Edom means red. Let me read it from Amplified. And Esau said to Jacob, please let me have a quick swallow of that red stuff there because I'm exhausted and famished. For that reason, Esau was also called Edom, red. But Jacob said, sell me your birthright as of this day. Jacob said, sell me your birthright, your right of the firstborn. There's a translator notes in the Amplified that says, in later times, this was the right of the firstborn to take over as head of the family and to receive a double share of the inheritance. Deuteronomy 21:17. Let's read Deuteronomy 21:17 and says, but he shall acknowledge the son of the unloved wife as the firstborn by giving him a double portion of all that he has. For he is the beginning of his strength. The firstborn is his. The rewards given to Jacob appears to have been even greater. Genesis 27:37. It says, then Isaac answered and said to Esau, indeed, I have made him your master, and all his brethren I have given to him as servants. With grain and wine I have sustained him. What shall I do now for you, my son? Furthermore, in Jewish tradition, it was reported that before the tabernacle was set up, sacrifices were offered by the firstborn of the family. So it's very important. This is very important. This is something that many would probably die over. Oh, I'd rather die than give my birthright. It's like, in many ways, it's like if you was asked, you know, it's, one time I saw an episode, I think it was in The Simpsons or something. I know we shouldn't be watching that cartoon. It's a bad cartoon, but this is years ago. This is when I was young. I was a kid back then. Homer sold his soul for a donut. I don't know if you ever remember that episode. And it reminds me of John Bunyan. In one of his writings, he said, I think it's grace to the worst sinners. Something. In one of his writings that he gives his testimony, John Bunyan says that the devil would tempt him at times and tell him, for a pen will you sell your soul? And you know what? I have a bad testimony before I came to Christ. You know I was a Satanist before coming to the walk of Christ, and those who know my testimony, you could listen. It's somewhere around there in the list of sermons. And I had, at age 9, I was so desperate for a girlfriend, desperate for a wife, I ended up selling my soul for a girlfriend. Thank God I never received that girlfriend at age 9. But anyway, you know that when you're in that situation and you don't know the Lord, because Esau did not know God. And we see Hebrews talks about that. It tells us, don't be like Esau. Don't be like Esau. We shouldn't be like Esau. You know, that was crazy of Esau. It says in Hebrews 12:16, lest there be any fornicator or profane person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. Oh, brother, don't let yourself be like Esau. For you know that afterwards, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place for repentance, though he saw it diligently with tears. Oh, brothers and sisters, I want to read that passage from verse 14 to 17. I think I think 14 to 17 could give us the whole summation of that passage in Hebrews chapter 12. Pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord, looking carefully lest anyone fall short of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up cause trouble, and by this many become defiled, lest there be any fornicator or a profane person or godless person like Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For you know that afterwards, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place for repentance, though he sought it diligently with tears. Don't let us be like Esau. Don't let us love sin. Don't let us love sin to the point that we're willing to sell our salvation. You may say, well, we can't lose our salvation. Man, if you leave this walk with God, it's not that you could lose it. It's that you never was truly saved. Brothers and sisters, if after I'm serving the Lord, and I decided in my last day before I die, or last year, or whatever, if I decide to leave the walk of God, doesn't matter if I served the Lord for 30 years. You know what? If I left the walk of God before I die, I'm going to hell. And I was never truly saved. I just had an emotional moment. I thought I was, but I never was truly saved. I never truly knew the Lord. Because if you truly know the Lord, if you truly are saved, you won't leave him. It's impossible for you to leave him. And if you do leave him, you have to return right back, because you cannot live without him. Because he's the air you breathe. He is the blood that flows through your vein. Doesn't matter how good sin is. You will repent of it and you will walk back to the Lord. You will crawl on your knees and say, Lord, forgive me. Because many times before, I've tried to leave the walk of God. I tried to indulge in a sin or something in the past. And guess what? I keep on running back to the Lord, asking the blood of Jesus to cleanse me. Because I cannot stay in my sin. I cannot see my life without Jesus. I cannot see myself leaving that walk and living a life of sin all my life, filling my mouth with mud and worms and maggots. And indulging in sin, I cannot see myself staying there. And I know that if you're saved, and right now, if you're hearing this message and you're in that mess, if you're indulging in some sin, whether sexual, whether drugs or alcohol, whatever it may be, you know you feel terrible. And you know you need to ask the blood of Jesus to cleanse you. Don't wait too long. Because if you wait too long, you will die in your sins and you will be lost in hell. And because you were never truly saved, if that happens. Anyway, let's continue. Verse 32. I want to continue with the Amplified Bible. Esau said, look, I'm about to die if I do not eat soon. So of what use is this birthright to me? Jacob said, swear an oath to me today that you are selling it to me for this food. So he swore an oath to him and sold him his birthright. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate it and drank and got up and went on his way. In this way, Esau scorned his birthright. Brothers and sisters, may that not be said of you and me. May we not scorn our birthright, which is through Jesus, the firstborn son of the Father, first begotten of the Father, through whom we also are begotten, Jesus, who is God and man. You know what? When you're preaching, you know you're allowed to speak in tongues because many times you're interpreting that tongue through your sermon. I believe so. I believe that. I don't know. I don't know about you, but I believe that. Anyway. Or maybe I'm just finding an excuse to speak in tongues. I don't know. Let's listen to a hymn, A Child of the King.
Smiling, but some of you are not. And I want you to sing this song like you believe it. Are you a child of the King this morning? Okay, then I want to hear a big difference on the last verse. Here we go, verse 4.
Hallelujah. How many of you are a child of that King? Let's go to our Bible reading fellowship right now, where we're in Genesis, I believe, 36. And after that, we'll be going to our New Testament Bible reading time. But before that, of course, we're going to have our Bible trivia time. Hope you guys are alert, especially in the first verses, because that's what I usually test you on, are the first verses that we listen to in the chapter. Anyway, let's go to Genesis 36, and we'll listen to our Bible reading fellowship. Genesis 36.
Chapter 36. Now these are the generations of Esau, who is Edom.
Esau took his wives of the daughters of Canaan, Ada, the daughter of Elon the Hittite, and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anah, the daughter of Zibeon the Hivite, and Bashemath, Ishmael's daughter, sister of Nebajoth. And Ada bare to Esau Eliphaz, and Bashemath bare Reuel, and Aholibamah bare Jeush, and Jaalam, and Korah. These are the sons of Esau, which were born unto him in the land of Canaan. And Esau took his wives, and his sons, and his daughters, and all the persons of his house, and his cattle, and all his beasts, and all his substance, which he had got in the land of Canaan, and went into the country from the face of his brother Jacob. For their riches were more than that they might dwell together, and the land wherein they were strangers could not bear them because of their cattle. Thus dwelt Esau in Mount Seir. Esau is Edom. And these are the generations of Esau, the father of the Edomites in Mount Seir. These are the names of Esau's sons: Eliphaz, the son of Ada, the wife of Esau; Reuel, the son of Bashemath, the wife of Esau. And the sons of Eliphaz were Teman, Omar, Zepho, and Gatam, and Kenaz. And Timnah was concubine to Eliphaz, Esau's son, and she bare to Eliphaz Amalek. These were the sons of Ada, Esau's wife. And these are the sons of Reuel: Nahath, and Zerah, Shammah, and Mizah. These were the sons of Bashemath, Esau's wife. And these were the sons of Aholibamah, the daughter of Anah, the daughter of Zibeon, Esau's wife. And she bare to Esau Jeush, and Jaalam, and Korah. These were dukes of the sons of Esau: the sons of Eliphaz, the firstborn son of Esau, Duke Teman, Duke Omar, Duke Zepho, Duke Kenaz, Duke Korah, Duke Gatam, and Duke Amalek. These are the dukes that came of Eliphaz in the land of Edom. These were the sons of Ada. And these are the sons of Reuel, Esau's son: Duke Nahath, Duke Zerah, Duke Shammah, Duke Mizah. These are the dukes that came of Reuel in the land of Edom. These are the sons of Bashemath, Esau's wife. And these are the sons of Aholibamah, Esau's wife: Duke Jeush, Duke Jaalam, Duke Korah. These were the dukes that came of Aholibamah, the daughter of Anah, Esau's wife. These are the sons of Esau, who is Edom, and these are their dukes. These are the sons of Seir the Horite, who inhabited the land: Lotan, and Shobal, and Zibeon, and Anah, and Dishon, and Ezer, and Dishan. These are the dukes of the Horites, the children of Seir, in the land of Edom. And the children of Lotan were Horai, and Hemam, and Lotan's sister was Timnah. And the children of Shobal were these: Alvan, and Manahath, and Ebel, Shepho, and Onam. And these are the children of Zibeon, both Aja and Anah. This was that Anah that found the mules in the wilderness as he fed the asses of Zibeon his father. And the children of Anah were these: Dishon, and Aholibamah, the daughter of Anah. And these are the children of Dishon: Hemdan, and Eshban, and Ithran, and Kiran. The children of Ezer are these: Bilhan, and Zeavan, and Achan. The children of Dishan are these: Uz, and Aaron. These are the dukes that came of the Horites: Duke Lotan, Duke Shobal, Duke Zibeon, Duke Anah, Duke Dishan, Duke Ezer, Duke Dishan. These are the dukes that came of Horai among their dukes in the land of Seir. And these are the kings that reigned in the land of Edom before there reigned any king over the children of Israel. And Bela the son of Beor reigned in Edom, and the name of his city was Dinhabah. And Bela died, and Jobab the son of Zerah of Bozrah reigned in his stead. And Jobab died, and Husham of the land of Temani reigned in his stead. And Husham died, and Hadad the son of Bedad, who smote Midian in the field of Moab, reigned in his stead. And the name of his city was Abith. And Hadad died, and Samla of Masrekah reigned in his stead. And Samla died, and Saul of Rehoboth by the river reigned in his stead. And Saul died, and Baal-Hanan the son of Achbor reigned in his stead. And Baal-Hanan the son of Achbor died, and Hadar reigned in his stead. And the name of his city was Peyu. And his wife's name was Mehetabel, the daughter of Matred, the daughter of Mazahab. And these are the names of the dukes that came of Esau according to their families after their places by their names. Duke Timnah, Duke Alva, Duke Jetheth, Duke Aholibamah, Duke Elah, Duke Pinon, Duke Kenaz, Duke Teman, Duke Mibzar, Duke Magdiel, Duke Iram. These be the dukes of Edom, according to their habitations in the land of their possession. He is Esau, the father of the Edomites.
Hallelujah, a whole chapter on Esau. Anyway. I just looked and I just found out something. Another question that I was going to ask you guys. This chapter is a listing of the generation of who? Jacob, Esau, Abraham, Israel. Of course, I already said it is Esau. But let's go to the following question. He took his wives of the daughter of who? The daughters of who? Of Canaan, Capernaum, Egypt, or Israel? Who did Esau took his wives of the daughter of? Israel, Egypt, Capernaum, or Canaan? We'll find out after this song. Let's play the song, How Great Thou Art. I love that song. How Great Thou Art. Love that song since the first time I...
Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the world's thy hand have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How thou art, how great thou art.
great song. Hallelujah. God is so great. Anyway, we have the question, and we have the answer right now. He took his wives as the daughters of who? Of Israel, Egypt, or Capernaum, or Canaan? And the answer is Canaan. He took his wives of the daughters of Canaan. See this in Genesis 36, verse 2. Esau took his wives of the daughters of Canaan. Now let's go to the next question. Why did he move away from his brother? Number one, did he fear him? Number two, his brother ordered him to move. Number three, they had so much riches, the land could not bear them. Or number four, the people of that place forced them out. Again, Genesis 36, the question is, why did he move away from his brother? Because he feared him? Because his brother ordered him to move? They had so much riches, the land could not bear them? Or the people of that place forced him out? Find out the answer after this song break. Let's listen to the song Day by Day. Hallelujah. Day by Day. Surely is a day by day battle that we have to face. Hallelujah. We're going to find out the answer to the question that was asked. And that was, why did he move? Why did Esau move away from his brother Jacob? Was it because he feared him? Was it because his brother ordered him to? Was it that they had too much riches, the land could not bear them? Or was it that the people placed of that place forced them out? And the answer is, they had so much riches, the land cannot bear them. That's in Genesis 36, verse 6 and 7. And Esau took his wives and his sons and his daughters and all the persons of his house and his cattle and all his beasts and all his substance in which he had got in the land of Canaan and went into the country from the face of his brother Jacob, for their riches were more than that they might dwell together, and the land wherein they were strangers could not bear them because of their cattle. They couldn't be there. They had too much riches. Anyway, let's go to Mark chapter 8, and we're in our New Testament Bible reading time. We're in Mark chapter 8. Let's enjoy the New Testament. We're reading from the New Living Translation when it comes to the New Testament. Hope you can enjoy it. I believe you will. I love it. I love the Word of God. It's so a blessing just to hear the Word of God and to meditate in it day and night. Brothers and sisters, it's a wonderful thing about being involved in this podcast. You don't just enjoy the Word of God. I enjoy the Word of God too. I enjoy hearing the Word of God, not just me preaching it. I also sit down and meditate on what's being read and meditate on the songs that are sang and even the stories that I've written in the past. It gives me things to meditate. And I said before, I'm not going to be talking about politics anymore. There's lots of things to talk about. When it comes to politics, you can find your head explode of all the bad things, unless I feel like like something is needful to write about or talk about, like emergency, Antichrist is right next to us or something. Then I'll probably give a word or two about it. But unless it's something like that, then I'm just going to just keep away from politics and just stick to the Word at this moment. There's enough things to worry about. And the Word of God gives us peace. And I want us to meditate on that peace and focus on the peace of God, because the world around us is falling apart. It's only in Jesus that we find it full, we find it complete. Let's listen to Mark chapter 8.
Mark chapter 8. About this time, another large crowd had gathered, and the people ran out of food again. Jesus called his disciples and told them, "I feel sorry for these people. They have been here with me for 3 days, and they have nothing left to eat. If I send them home hungry, they will faint along the way, for some of them have come a long distance." His disciples replied, "How are we supposed to find enough food to feed them out here in the wilderness?" Jesus asked, "How much bread do you have?" "7 loaves," they replied. So Jesus told all the people to sit down on the ground. Then he took the 7 loaves, thanked God for them, and broke them into pieces. He gave them to his disciples, who distributed the bread to the crowd. A few small fish were found too, so Jesus also blessed these and told the disciples to distribute them. They ate as much as they wanted. Afterward, the disciples picked up 7 large baskets of leftover food. There were about 4,000 men in the crowd that day, and Jesus sent them home after they had eaten. Immediately after this, he got into a boat with his disciples and crossed over to the region of Dalmanutha. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had arrived, they came and started to argue with him. Testing him, they demanded that he show them a miraculous sign from heaven to prove his authority. When he heard this, he sighed deeply in his spirit and said, "Why do these people keep demanding a miraculous sign? I tell you the truth, I will not give this generation any such sign." So he got back into the boat and left them, and he crossed to the other side of the lake. But the disciples had forgotten to bring any food. They had only one loaf of bread with them in the boat. As they were crossing the lake, Jesus warned them, "Watch out! Beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and of Herod." At this, they began to argue with each other because they hadn't brought any bread. Jesus knew what they were saying, so he said, "Why are you arguing about having no bread? Don't you know or understand even yet? Are your hearts too hard to take it in? You have eyes, can't you see? You have ears, can't you hear? Don't you remember anything at all? When I fed the 5,000 with 5 loaves of bread, how many baskets of leftovers did you pick up afterward?" 12, they said. "And when I fed the 4,000 with 7 loaves, how many large baskets of leftovers did you pick up?" 7, they said. "Don't you understand yet?" he asked them. When they arrived at Bethsaida, some people brought a blind man to Jesus, and they begged him to touch the man and heal him. Jesus took the blind man by the hand and led him out of the village. Then, spitting on the man's eyes, he laid his hands on him and asked, "Can you see anything now?" The man looked around. "Yes," he said, "I see people, but I can't see them very clearly. They look like trees walking around." Then Jesus placed his hands on the man's eyes again, and his eyes were opened. His sight was completely restored, and he could see everything clearly. Jesus sent him away, saying, "Don't go back into the village on your way home." Jesus and his disciples left Galilee and went up to the villages near Caesarea Philippi. As they were walking along, he asked them, "Who do people say I am?" "Well," they replied, "some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say you are one of the other prophets." Then he asked them, "But who do you say I am?" Peter replied, "You are the Messiah." But Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. Then Jesus began to tell them that the Son of Man must suffer many terrible things and be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. He would be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. As he talked about this openly with his disciples, Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Jesus turned around and looked at his disciples, then reprimanded Peter. "Get away from me, Satan," he said. "You are seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God's." Then, calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, "If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way, take up your cross, and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my message in these adulterous and sinful days, the Son of Man will be ashamed of that person when he returns in the glory of his Father with the holy angels."
Praise the Lord. Let's go to Mark chapter 8. And it says, how long, the question is in Mark chapter 8, how long had the crowd been with Jesus with nothing to eat? That's the question that we have for the New Testament. How long had the crowd been with Jesus without nothing to eat? Was it all day, 2 days, 3 days, or 4 days? Again, how long had the crowd been with Jesus with nothing to eat? Was it all day? Was it 2 days? Was it 3 days? Was it 4 days? Find out after this song break. And we're going to go to the song, "Faith is the Victory."
Thank you. Let's all stand as we sing.
The Lord. Let's go to the question. How long had the crowd been with Jesus with nothing to eat? And the answer is they were there 3 days without nothing to eat. That's in Mark 8 verse 2. I have compassion on the multitude because they have been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. The answer was 3 days. Let's go one more question, and then we're done with the questions, and we're about, and then we'll go for prayer, and we'll finish our podcast today. How much food did the disciples have? Again, the question is, how much food did the disciples have? Did they have 5 loaves and 3 fishes? 5 fishes and 3 loaves, 7 loaves and few fishes, 7 fishes and few loaves. Again, the question is, how much food did the disciples have? Did they have 5 loaves and 3 fishes, 5 fishes and 3 loaves, 7 loaves and a few fishes, 7 fishes and a few loaves? Find out after this song break. And we're going to go to the song, The Wonder of All, The Wonder of It All.
There's the wonder of sunset at evening, the wonder as sunrise I see. But the wonder of wonders that thrills my soul is the wonder that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Wonder of it all, the wonder of it all.
just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves me. Oh, the wonder of it all, the wonder of it all, just to think that God loves you. Just to think that God loves you.
The answer to the question, how much food did the disciples have, was 7 loaves and a few fishes. Again, the answer to the question was 7 loaves and a few fishes. And we can find this at Mark chapter 8, verse 5 through 7. And he asked them, how many loaves have ye? And they said, 7. And he commanded the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and gave thanks and brake, and gave to his disciples to set before them. And they did set them before the people, and they had a few small fishes. And he blessed and commanded to set them before them. Also before them. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for those who are hearing this podcast and will be hearing this podcast, that you may bless them spiritually, physically, emotionally, mentally, financially. Lord God, break every chain, every bond, bring healing upon their bodies, because you're the same God of yesterday, today, and forever. We pray, Lord God, that you would continue equipping me to teach the Word of God and to be strong in this podcast and continue till the end. And I just thank you, Lord God, for every single thing that you do. I thank you for the wonders that you're doing. I thank you for the great things I'm going to be seeing you do. And just thank you, Lord. I praise you for everything that you're doing, Lord God. I pray that you will give us a spirit to witness to those who are lost. And in Jesus' mighty name, amen. I just want to give you all the phone number to call if you need prayer. It's 215-432-6287. Again, the phone number to call if you need prayer is 215-432-6287. And if you wish to send your testimony, you can send it at revkakoulides@gmail.com. I recently read a testimony, and this was from a descendant of Charles Spurgeon. The man was not saved, actually, but he was a great, great, great grandson, I believe, of Charles Spurgeon, and he got saved. And it was a great testimony. I read it. It was somewhere on Facebook. I read it. He was an atheist. You would think that he would have been not atheist, a believer. But yeah, he was an atheist and he got saved. Someone preached to him the Word of God 8 months ago and he got saved. God is so awesome. Anyway, let's give the blessings to us to leave. Also, if you wish to send an offering, I don't ask every podcast this. I sometimes ask like once a month, or probably not even that, or once every couple of weeks or so. I don't know. You could send an offering at 2912 Ellis Street, Philadelphia, PA 19134, and it will be greatly needed for the podcast. But if you don't send an offering, you don't have to. Because, really, the Lord has provided for this podcast, and He will continue providing for this podcast. But we just need you to be listening more than actually sending offerings. I'm just saying that just in case God touches your heart to send something. I won't deny it. Don't worry. I'm just put it under my name, Harris Kakoulides. Anyway, the Lord bless you, and I'll see you in the next program of Mr. Kakoulides and the Bible Podcast. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. And the Church of God says, Amen. So long, love you. See you tomorrow night.